Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. Many of you had a question about the impedance related topics like what is impedance, what is input and output impedance of the circuit, and what is the loading effect in the circuit. So let us see these questions one by one. And first let us understand about the impedance. So in a simple way, if I say the impedance is the measure of opposition to the flow of current that is presented by the circuit or the network whenever the voltage signal is applied. Now this impedance is more relevant term whenever the applied input signal is AC sinusoidal signal. And in a way, this impedance is similar to the resistance, which also implies the opposition to the flow of current. But the resistance is the frequency independent. It means that suppose you have any resistive network or simple resistor, and if you operate this network at, let's say, DC voltage or at 100 kHz, then the value of the resistance will not change with the frequency. On the other end, the impedance of the circuit will change with the frequency because it involves the reactive elements like capacitor and the inductor. Now, in case of this inductor and the capacitor, the resistance that is offered by these elements is known as the reactance, and it is denoted by the symbol of X. So for the inductive reactance, it is denoted as XL, and for the capacitive reactance, it is denoted as XC. Now the value of this inductive reactance will be equal to J into omega L, while the value of this capacitive reactance will be equal to 1 divided by J omega C. And we have already derived these expressions in the earlier video of phasor diagram. Now this reactance is nothing but ratio of the voltage and current. That means the voltage that is applied across this inductor or the capacitor and the current that is flowing through this inductor. So if we simply take the ratio of this voltage and current, then we will get the reactance of either inductor or capacitor. And the unit of this reactance is ohm. Now if we only consider the magnitude of this reactance, then for the inductive reactance, it will be equal to omega L, and for the capacitive reactance, it will be equal to 1 divided by omega C. So as you can see over here, this inductive and the capacitive reactances are frequency dependent. It means that with frequency, the value of this reactance will change. Now suppose your circuit contains the resistive element as well as some reactive element, then the total resistance that is offered by the circuit is known as the impedance, and it is denoted by the symbol of Z. So the total impedance will be the summation of this resistive element as well as reactive element. So here, in this case, the total impedance will be equal to R plus J omega L. Now many times this impedance is also represented in the polar form. It means that it has some finite magnitude as well as some finite phase. Now the magnitude of this impedance can be given by this expression, that is the square root of this R square plus X square, where X is the reactance of the circuit. And the phase of this impedance can be found by this expression, that is the tan inverse of X divided by R. Now similar to the resistance, this impedance is also a ratio of voltage and current. So for any particular network or circuit, if impedance is represented like this, it means that the voltage will lead the current by some phase angle 5. And moreover that, the ratio of the voltage and current signal will give the magnitude of the impedance. So now similarly, for any given circuit, we can find the impedance. So for example, here for this particular circuit, the impedance will be equal to the parallel combination of R and this capacitive reactance XC. So in this way, we can find the impedance for any given circuit. Now it is quite possible that the impedance of the given circuit can be either purely resistive or purely reactive, and in most of the times it used to be a combination of resistive as well as the reactive part. So in general, for the AC signal, the resistance that is offered by the circuit is known as the impedance. So now once we understood about this impedance, let us understand about the input and output impedance. So let's say we have one circuit, and to this circuit some voltage source V is connected at the input terminals. Now if we see this circuit from the source perspective, then the impedance that is offered by the circuit is known as the input impedance. So if we see the equivalent circuit from the source perspective, then it will look like this. So this input impedance is the impedance that is observed by the voltage source between the two terminals of the circuit. Now here we are assuming that the applied voltage source is ideal source, but in actual case this voltage source will also have some finite resistance. So if you see the equivalent circuit, then the equivalent circuit will look like this. Now ideally this entire input voltage V should also appear across the two terminals of this input impedance, but because of this finite series resistance there will be some voltage drop across this resistor, and because of that, let's say the voltage which appears across this input impedance is equal to V dash. So this V dash will be equal to V times this input impedance Zin divided by Zin plus RS. So as you can see over here, because of this finite series resistance, there will be some drop across this resistor, and because of that, the actual voltage which appears across this input impedance will be less than the input voltage. So this phenomenon is known as the loading effect. So this loading effect can be minimized by having very large input impedance. For example, if the input impedance of the circuit is much larger than this series resistance, in that case, this voltage V dash will be approximately equal to the input voltage V. On the other hand, if this input impedance is comparable to this series resistance RS, in that case, this voltage V dash will be less than the input voltage V. So for any circuit, the input impedance should be as high as possible so that the entire voltage will appear across the circuit. So now similarly, let us understand about the output impedance. So let's say in the circuit, we have connected some load at the output terminal, and let's say the circuit is giving some output voltage VO. Now ideally, this output voltage Vout should also appear across the two terminal of this load. But from the load perspective, if you see, it will also see some finite resistance in series with this output voltage. So this finite resistance is known as the output impedance of the circuit. So because of this finite series resistance, the actual voltage which appears across this load will be less than the output voltage. So let's say the voltage which appears across the load is equal to VO dash, and this VO dash will be equal to VO times ZL divided by ZL plus Z out. So as you can see over here, because of this output impedance, the actual voltage which appears across the load will be less than this voltage VO. So now if this output impedance is comparable to the load impedance, in that case, the actual voltage which appears across the load will be less than the output voltage V out. So this is also a one kind of loading effect, and it can be minimized by having this output impedance as minimum as possible. So by having this output impedance as minimum as possible, we can increase the output voltage which appears across the load. So in this way, for any circuit, the input impedance should be as high as possible, while the output impedance should be as minimum as possible. So this input and output impedance are very crucial parameters when we are cascading either two circuits or systems. So now let's say two amplifiers are cascaded to amplify the input signal. So let's say in this system, the input voltage Vin is applied, and at the output terminal of the system, some load RL is connected, and the output voltage across this load is equal to Vout. Now here, assume that Zin1 and the ZO1 are the input and output impedance of the first amplifier, while the Zin2 and the ZO2 are the input and output impedance of the second amplifier. Now here, ideally the same input voltage Vin should appear across the two terminal of this amplifier 1. But the actual value will depend upon the value of this input impedance. So to get the maximum input voltage across this first amplifier, the value of this input impedance Zin1 should be as high as possible. Now let's say after the first amplifier, the output of the amplifier is equal to VO1. Now this VO1 is directly given to this second amplifier. So ideally, the same VO1 should also appear across the input terminal of this second amplifier. But because of the finite input impedance of this second amplifier, as well as the finite output impedance of this first amplifier, the actual voltage which appears at the input of the second amplifier will be slightly less than this VO1, and let us say it is equal to VO1 dash. So by maximizing the input impedance of the second amplifier and minimizing the output impedance of the first amplifier, we can increase the output voltage VO1 dash that appears across the second amplifier. Similarly, let us assume that the output of the second amplifier is equal to VO2. Now, depending upon the value of this output impedance of the second amplifier, the voltage VO will appear across the load. So to get the maximum output voltage across the load, the output impedance of the second amplifier should be minimum. So in this way, this input and output impedance plays a major role whenever the circuits are cascaded. So to avoid the loading effect, the value of the input impedance for the circuit should be as high as possible, and the value of the output impedance should be as low as possible. So I hope in this video, you briefly understood about the input and output impedance of the circuit. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.